Philippians chapter 2. If you have any encouragement, Philippians 2:1, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from His love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and in purpose. We cannot be uniform. God is not calling us to uniformity. There's a difference between uniformity and unity. Uniformity is found in certain religious groups where everybody has to wear the same outfits. Everybody has to have the same kind of haircut. Everybody has to speak only the same language. Everybody has to eat the same kind of food. There's one universally they will follow one way of life, doing things from every small detail. That is that takes away the freedom. This is not uniformity which takes away the freedom, but this is unity in spirit and in purpose. For the purpose of the kingdom of God, for the purpose of the building of His church, of His kingdom, for the purpose of His work, for His glory, that we love one another, we live together, we pray for one another, we care for one another, where we understand each other, where we give and take with each other, we share and care with each other, and we are like-minded for God's purpose and for His work. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. The Bible says about divisive people, the opposite aspect of what is being like-minded is being divisive. The Bible says, warn a divisive man and keep away from him. You know, God wants us to keep away from divisions. So anybody who's speaking anything that will cause divisions, you know, anything that is not gracious, that is not good, that is not healthy. You know, some people will say, get together, two or three people will get together and say something bad about someone else, or something bad about the church, or this is not how it should be done, this is not what should be done, you know. And this is why, you know, this person is like that, that's what happened to this person said about that person, you know, they have gossips, conversations about each other, about somebody else, about a third person, and they cause divisions by having conversations. So if there are conversations like that, gossips like that, we need to get rid of those things. If somebody comes and gossips to you and tells you, don't tell anybody, you know, this is what it seems, that's what they did, this is what they said. Somebody comes and gossips to you, tell them, oh, don't worry, next time I see them, I'll ask them. They will never gossip to you again. Amen. Praise the Lord. And you know, God has a beautiful way of exposing gossips. God has a beautiful way of exposing what is spoken even in darkness. He brings them to light. That's what the Bible says. That what is even spoken in darkness, what is done in darkness, God will bring to light. Hallelujah. The Spirit of God exposes it. You know, the prophets of God were able to hear what was spoken in king's bedrooms. Hallelujah. That's why in SABC we used to say even walls have ears in SABC. That's a Bible college where I studied. You know, so everybody would be very careful of what they are saying, because they say something and sometimes God exposes them. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So remember, the Holy Spirit is there and He's the one who brings peace. He's the one who brings unity. And He is not the one who divides. Hallelujah. And so anybody who comes to the conversation with a mentality of division is not carrying the right spirit. Is not carrying the right spirit. Why are we talking about it? Because we're talking about we ought to be a family of families. And if we have to be a family of families, we have to preserve our unity. If we have to preserve our unity, we need to shut our mouths from gossip.
Amen. We got to shut our mouths from gossip. If we allow gossip, you know, and God brings out gossip. Who's talking what and who's saying what to whom. Everything God exposes, you know. And that will only work against us. And some people who got exposed, you know, are put to shame terribly. Because what they said or what they did got exposed. Amen. Hallelujah. And so it's important that we do not allow that kind of thing. And the fire of the Holy Spirit is there among the community of God's people. And that fire of the Spirit will burn away all of those chaff. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. That God, the Spirit of God will bring conviction. The Spirit of God will bring transformation. He will change hearts. He will change minds. He will change attitudes which lead to division. But God is a God who unites. God is a God of love. God is a God who binds us together. God is a God who brings us together. He is a God who initiated His church and He wants us to be in unity. And the Apostle Paul is constantly writing and exhorting his church to be united. Hallelujah. A house that is divided will? A house that is divided will? That's what Jesus said. Amen. Praise the Lord. A house that is united will? Stand. Amen. So do you want to fall or do you want to stand? Amen. Do you want to stand? Amen. Hallelujah. We will stand together if we will be united together. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And so if there is any gossip, any conversation, anything evil, anybody saying, any divisive word, get rid of it. Amen. Hallelujah. Any accusations? The devil is the accuser of the brethren, the Bible says. The devil is the accuser of the brethren. And so people will come with accusations. They will say, oh, you know, they said like this, they did like that. You know, accusations. That's from the devil. Amen. False accusations. Judas was among the brethren themselves. So it's important that we don't turn out to be a Judas Iscariot. The one who was among them, with them, you know, lifted the heel against them. Amen. So it's important. Sometimes getting critical about everything can attract spirit of criticism. Getting critical about everything can attract a spirit of criticism. And so we can never be able to think positive, never be able to be appreciative, never be able to love, never be able to be united. But always there'll be a spirit of criticism that will operate. Some people have a spirit of criticism. It becomes not second nature, but first nature. It becomes a habit slowly, you know, practiced again and again, becomes a nature. A habit practiced again and again becomes a nature. And so it's important that we are careful that we do not allow evil things, evil habits. Evil habits, probably we were used to such things before we knew Christ, or probably those things have continued on even after we have known Christ and made a commitment to Christ. But if such things are there, where there's always a spirit of criticism of things that happened in the past, things that some others are saying, if we are carrying that and if we are repeating that to everybody and if we are always, you know, involved with such kind of critical attitudes and conversations, that will become counterproductive to yourself. That will work against you. You know, that will turn against you at different times. You know, your own criticism will turn against you. And so it's important that we are very, very careful that we are not being critical all the time. Not having a critical mindset. There are some people who have a special gift of finding fault with everything. That's a unique gift for some people. They can find fault like that. They can find fault even before anything happened. Assuming that something is going to happen and that's going to be faulty. And they have the expertise of finding fault even before certain things or anything can happen. They can project faults, mistakes in other people's lives. That's what I call a spirit of criticism. This is something that is from the devil. If that's a spirit of criticism, you identify that in your life, you get rid of it right away. Because that's from the devil. That's not good for you. That's not good for your life. That's not good for your family. You know, always critical, always finding fault, always being judgmental. That will attract a spirit of criticism that will begin to operate in a person's life, and they can never, never love. They will never be in unity with anybody, and they can never, never adjust and live life with anyone. Amen. Especially for those of you who are yet to be married, learn it early. Amen. Because you will have a whole lot of adjustment to do when you get married. And so learn to adjust in life. Some people are so agitated about anything that is inconvenient, anything that is causing some discomfort. They get very agitated. They'll start making a lot of noise about it. Any small difficulty, any small delay, anything, any place they have to go and stand in a queue for some time, they can't wait, they can't be patient. You know, these are things that will destroy unity. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Amen. Praise the Lord. The Bible says here, verse 2, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and in purpose. Make every effort to hold on to the bond of peace. Make every effort. It takes effort to live in peace with one another. It takes effort to keep the unity. It takes a lot of effort. Everybody has to put in effort. It doesn't come easily. But it's easy to be critical. It's easy to gossip. It's easy to be easy to, you know, some people are waiting for a controversy to happen. They wait for the latest controversy to come about. And they have something to talk about for the next 1 week. Waiting for the latest controversy. You know, so let's get rid of all of those things. Those are things that cause division. Those are things that divide people. Those are things that divide families. Those are things that will divide a church. Those are things that will divide a fellowship. Those are things that will destroy love. Those are things that will destroy unity. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So let's get out of the critical mindset. Let's get out of our prejudices, biases. Let's get out of the gossips. Let us get out of all of those things, you know, which are contrary to love, which are contrary to unity, and let's hold on to the bond of peace. Let's make every effort to live in unity, in love, and hold on to the purposes of God. Hallelujah. Why are we here together? We are here together to build God's kingdom. Amen. Why are we here together? To build God's kingdom. Amen. If you believe you are part of God's kingdom, if you believe you are part of God's church, you're here to build it. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And so we got to make every effort to keep that, to do that. And so to be the family of families, let's pray for this. To love and to be in a spirit of unity and purpose. And the devil brings division. The devil is the accuser of the brethren. And so we got to rebuke that devil who brings disunity, the devil who brings accusations. We got to rebuke that enemy that brings that and pray that God will help us, give us a heart of love that will make every effort to love one another and to be forgiving to one another and be a true community of grace. Can we just stand together and pray for this? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Holding our hands with one another, standing next to us, holding our hands with each other. And I want to just request Sister Grace Bernard, would you still just lead us in prayer for this? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Shall we pray out loud? Everybody, let's lift our voices and pray. Come on. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Worship you, Jesus.
Worship you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, for this wonderful gathering,
Lord.
So people gathered in one accord, Father.
Yes,
we are so grateful to you, Father, for this gathering, Lord. We thank you, praise him. May the Spirit take full control of this unity, Lord. Let us be united in our families, in the church, Father God, for you. Let us all prepare ourselves for your coming, Father God. Let us be united till your coming, Father God.
Yes, Father.
And bring people into your kingdom.
Yes, Father.
Father God.
Hallelujah.
All the people who are appointed for salvation,
Jesus, thank
may they
you,
run
Father.
Into the sheepfold, Father God.
Yes, Father.
As early as possible, Father. We thank you, praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Let's sing the song, Bind Us Together with Cords of Love. Amen. Hallelujah. Bind us together with cords that cannot be broken.
Bind us together. Bind us together. Bind us together with love. There is only one God.
Person standing next to us, or put an arm around their shoulder. Can we sing it together once?
Bind us together, bind us together with cords that cannot be broken. Bind us together, Lord. Bind us together, Lord. Bind us together with
morning. We pray that you'll bind our hearts together in unity, in spirit, in love, for one purpose, for your purpose, Lord, for your kingdom, Lord. And let the enemy be kicked out in Jesus' name. While we pray together in unity, the enemy will have no place. Hallelujah. The enemy will fall. Every spirit of division we cast away in Jesus' name. Every spirit and conversation and gossip of division, we cast it out in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. bind every family together, Lord. Husband, wife, and children be bound together with cords of love. We as a family of families, we together be bound with love. Pour out your love into our hearts. Pour out your love into our hearts. Pour out your love into our hearts, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Let there be love, Lord. Let there be love shared among us. Hallelujah. Oh, yes, Lord. Oh, yes, Lord. Ramananda Ramangaradanana. Oh, Ramamama Sharararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararararar bangarana shirarana na bangarana na ora bara manandara bagarindare re 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 bagarindare shirarana. We rebuke in Jesus name. Ora mama mama shanana mangarandara rarara re bagarindare re re bagar shirarara bagarandara mangarandara. Every spirit, every unclean spirit, come out in Jesus' name. Leave in Jesus' name. Unclean spirit, leave in Jesus' name. Ora mama ma shara bangaranana. Ora barangaranana. Ora bangaranana. Unholy attitudes, unholy alliances be broken in Jesus' name. Unholy alliances be broken in Jesus' name. Oh, the fire. Oh, the fire of the Lord. Cleanse, Lord. Conviction, let the conviction of the Holy Spirit, convicting voice of the Holy Spirit, fire of the Holy Spirit. Oh, burn the chaff, Lord. Burn the chaff. Burn the chaff. Fire. Oh, shara bangaranana shara. Ura bangaranana bangaranana shara bangaranana. Ura bangaranana. Yes,
Lord, let there be love shed among us. Let there be love in our eyes. Lead out your love.
Father. Oh, yes, Lord. Jesus. Yes, Father. The compassion of Christ fill our hearts. Give us a heart of love. Make us a community of grace. Help us to be gracious. Let our words be seasoned with salt. Help us to be gracious, Lord. A spirit of discernment against everything that the enemy brings to divide. Let there be a spirit of discernment, Lord, for every one of us. We pray for a spirit of discernment that we will identify every spirit that divides and we will be able to resist it, rebuke it,
yes, Jesus,
and cast it away. Bind every family with love. Every husband and wife be bound with love. May they be one flesh. If anything that has brought in division, let them be bound again with love. Once again. Every brother and sister, every parents and children, Lord, be bound together with love. Once again, in Jesus' name. Every family be bound together with love with each other. Once again. Together as a church will be in one accord, united in spirit and in purpose. According to your word, we ask, Lord, as according to your word, to be united in spirit and in purpose. As Apostle Paul wrote to the church at Philippi, to be united in spirit and in purpose. Hallelujah. For in chapter 4 of Philippians, in verse 2, we read, I plead with Euodia and I plead with Syntyche to agree with each other in the Lord. Yes, I ask you, loyal yoke fellow, help these women who have contended at my side in the cause of the gospel, along with Clement and the rest of my fellow workers whose names are in the book of life. These were people whose names were in the book of life. These are people who helped Apostle Paul, who contended at Paul's side, who were right hand to Apostle Paul in the ministry, in the work of the gospel, who contended at my side in the cause of the gospel, along with Clement, the rest of the fellow workers. But these two women, Euodia and Syntyche, are not agreeing with each other in the Lord. And that the church at Philippi have partnered with Apostle Paul in the progression of the gospel. Verse 14 of the same chapter, Philippians 4:14. Yet it was good of you to share in my troubles. Moreover, as you Philippians, please sit down. Moreover, as you Philippians know, in the early days of your acquaintance with the gospel, when I set out from Macedonia, not one church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving, except you only. For even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent me aid again and again when I was in need. The church at Philippi was supporting the expansion, progression of the gospel, which Apostle Paul was involved with. Even in chapter 1, he begins there in verse 4. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy because of your partnership, verse 5. In the gospel, from the first day until now, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion till the day of Christ. We always look at verse 6. But look at verse 5. That's the intent or why Apostle Paul is writing Philippians, because the Philippian church has been partnering in the gospel right from the beginning. And we also see in chapter 4, we read verse 14 to 17, verse 14 to 16 of chapter 4, that the church at Philippi have been partnering in the gospel in the matters of giving and receiving right from the beginning. And now we are, because Euodia and Syntyche have been fighting with each other and not agreeing with one another within the church, that's affecting the partnership of the gospel. And so he's telling his loyal yoke fellow, in most probably as scholars say, could be Dr. Luke, to call Euodia and Syntyche and talk to them and help them to agree with one another so that the partnership in the gospel, which the church of Philippi have been strong, will not be affected. Hallelujah. You see, our unity will help progress the gospel. Amen. When we come together united, sharing our resources, not just giving offerings and tithes, but sharing our hearts, sharing our lives, working hard, doing the work of evangelism, when we do all of this, we will see the gospel progressing outside. And so, so important that we agree together, not agreeing to disagree. That's the principle of the world, where we agree to disagree. You think differently, I think differently. We both agree that we are both different. So you think differently, I'll think differently, and we will part ways, but we'll be friends. That is the principle of the world. But here the principle of scriptures is that we agree together. Hallelujah. That we love the Lord with all our hearts, that we love one another as we love ourselves. The first commandment, the greatest commandment Jesus gave. Amen. Hallelujah. It's important that we are all committed to that. Aren't we committed to that? Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Some of the distinct things that happened in the church, in the early church, we find here in Acts of the Apostles, chapter number 13. We see the church of Antioch established, where apostles, those who have been scattered because of persecution in connection with Stephen, traveled far and wide away from Jerusalem, and so they started preaching the gospel. And the church was established. And you find in the church of Antioch in chapter 13, there were prophets and teachers. You see, it's a young church. In chapter 11, you find the birthing of the church. Chapter 13, of course, there was definitely a time span between these, because Paul and Barnabas stayed there and met with the church and taught great numbers of people for a whole year. We read that in 11:26. So people had grown, people have accepted the Lord, people have grown, people have received the gifts of the Spirit, and they were teachers already. People who were prophesying the gifts of the Spirit were operating in the church at Antioch. And Barnabas, Simon, Simeon called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manion, had been brought up with the Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. While they were all worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them." So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off. You see, this is the church at Antioch. They were praying together. And this prayer is not just praying for stomachache to go and headaches to leave and back pains to leave. Oftentimes our prayers are just all about back pain and headache and stomachache. Now those things will definitely have to be prayed for. Nothing wrong in praying for that. But that's a Sunday school level of prayer. Only praying for those things. Lord, bless me, bless my husband, bless my wife, bless my spouse, bless my mouse, bless my cat, bless the doggy, and bless me. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, that is Sunday school prayer. But here, while they are praying for the purposes of God, What is God's plan in this city? Amen. That's what we need to be praying for. And God will reveal. And God is, as they're praying for their city, as they're praying for God, for God's kingdom, for God's work, while they're praying for that, God is giving a direction. These are things that will happen while we come together and pray together as a church. While the Holy Spirit will give us a prompting to pray for a certain thing. Sometimes it'll be a prayer in the Spirit. It'll be a prayer that'll be led by the Holy Spirit so strongly, where sometimes you will feel a certain urge, a word that God will give you, a word of prophecy, which not necessarily is always necessarily have to be about something that is correcting us or something that is giving us an exhortation or an encouragement only. But also a word of prophecy can be giving us a direction. You find here a prophetic word that they are receiving while they're worshiping and the Lord and fasting and praying together. The Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. There's a work. They've already been doing the work. But here's a work of moving into an apostolic work, of going out into different cities and proclaiming the gospel and establishing churches and and raising up leaders and multiplying churches, of moving from city to city into an apostolic calling. And so God is revealing that. God is giving a distinct, clear, divine direction. And so it's so important that we come together as a church and pray together, and God will give us direction even about how we ought to reach out to people, whom we ought to reach out to, you know, what kind of a plan we should employ, what is God's strategy for the city. And each city, each place has to, we have to employ a different strategy, a different plan. You can't do the same thing that is done in the United States. The same methods, methodology will not apply in India. You know, you can't go out, you know, and do things the same way which works in another place. And so God will lead. God will give us a direction. And so that will happen only when we pray together. And who should do what? Who is called for what? You know, God will give us directions. There are prophets, there are people, teachers, there are leaders God has raised among us. You know, even among us who are sitting here, many of you are functioning in different capacities. And where God will give you a word, for anybody, God will give a word, and God will call people for His work, and God will lead us, you know, and He will give us divine direction. And so we find these are certain unique things that happen in the body of Christ, in a local church, in the church at Antioch, where there was a divine direction. And also sometimes God will also give, reveal things that are yet to come. In His church, for His church. These are things for His church, for everybody. Acts chapter 11, we find again in the church at Antioch, in verse 27 onwards, during this time some prophets came down from Jerusalem to Antioch. This is from the church at Jerusalem. They are coming to the church at Antioch because now many people got saved and they are growing in the Lord, and Paul and Barnabas are teaching for a whole year in the church at Antioch, and there's the evidence of the grace of God there. And so there are prophets coming down from Jerusalem to the church at Antioch. You see, in any true church, you know, God will send His people, God will send His prophets, God will send His servants, they will see the evidence of the grace of God and they will come. You see, in verse 23 also, when Barnabas arrived from Jerusalem, he arrived and saw the evidence of the grace of God. You see, there is a grace that is given to a church, which when men of God come, they will be able to see that. You know, even visiting preachers, speakers, servants of God who come will be able to confirm that. And by the grace of God, many, many times when servants of God have come and visited us, they've said certain specific things that they experience a certain presence of God in this place like nowhere else, in a very, very unique way. Many people have testified like that. And many people have testified the same thing, many different people, you know. You see, different people at different times, coming from different places, can't say the same thing just by accident. Am I right? So When God is there, when our focus and we're building His kingdom and His church biblically and according to the Word of God, and we are focused on scriptures and learning from scriptures and trying to practice that, you will see the evidence of the grace of God. Even in your life, you practice the Word of God, you read scriptures, you align your life according to God's pattern and according to God's Word. You know, not seeing, who will give more dowry. You know, will the father-in-law give a house or more property? You know, there's some people, you know, who are looking at things of the world, taking decisions or doing things the worldly wise, you know. But not that way, but we go according to God's plan, according to God's will, you know, live life or order our lives according to the Word of God, align our lives according to the Word of God. When you start doing that, and when we as a church start doing that, there's the evidence of the grace of God. People will be able to see the grace of God on your life. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. You know, the Bible says in Acts chapter 2 and verse number 47, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. Praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. The grace of God was upon them. And so they found favor in the eyes of people. And you see here what was happening, coming back to Acts 11, to the point, verse 27, Acts 11, 27. During this time, some prophets came down from Jerusalem to Antioch. One of them named Agabus stood up and through the Spirit predicted that a severe famine would spread over the entire Roman world. This happened during the reign of Claudius. The disciples, each according to his ability, decided to provide help for the brothers living in Judea. You see, there was a prophet, a company of prophets come to the church at Antioch. In his church, in God's church, you know, company of prophets will come. God's people will come. Men of God will love to come. Certain men of God come here and they say, this is like a refuge, a place of refuge for me. Amen. Hallelujah. Because they find the presence of God and the atmosphere of love and acceptance and unity and all of this that makes it so comfortable. You know, that they long to go to certain places. But in certain places, there'll be so much of disunity and infighting. People might be smiling outside all with lipstick on, you know, and got their hair done and all that. But we'll be smiling through all of that. But deep inside, it's all just makeover. It's just makeup, you know. But there's no real unity inside. It's no love inside. There's no sincerity inside. And so when genuine men of God go to such places, they will get very disturbed in their spirit. They will get very disturbed. And so you see, prophets come to the church at Antioch. We need company of prophets, servants of God, come visiting us, wanting to be here. Hallelujah. That's the kind of church our church must be. Amen. Hallelujah. Where servants of God will come and they were free. You know, they came to the church of Antioch and no tight systems there to bind them. You know, where you have to sit down here, when you have to stand up there, you know, and what time you have to start and what time you have to finish, and all of this, you know, was not systems put over them. They had the freedom and the Spirit to flow. And as the Spirit of God prompted them, they began to rise up and began to prophesy in the church at Antioch. They came from Jerusalem, but they're prophesying in the church at Antioch. Amen. Hallelujah. So we need, we will find that, you know, in God's church, when we are truly being the church that Jesus is building, when we are truly are the church that Jesus is building, when we are a family of families, when we are united, we will find divine direction about things that are yet to come, about plans of God. We first saw the plan of God in chapter 13. And hear about things that are yet to come. Warnings are given. Caution, word of caution is given. You see, this is how it is. It ought to be for us as a church. And as a church, you know, as they were together, what happened was Peter was imprisoned. The second thing we find is, firstly, we looked at divine direction, how God gives us divine direction. Second thing we're looking at is how God does dramatic miracles. Dramatic miracles. We find in chapter 12, in verse 1, it was about this time that King Herod arrested some who belonged to the church, intending to persecute them. He had James, the brother of John, put to death with a sword. When he saw that this pleased the Jews, he proceeded to seize Peter also. Oh, just because the Jews were very happy that James, the brother of John, was put to death, you know, just to please the Jews, they seized Peter also and arrested him. This happened during the Feast of Unleavened Bread. After arresting him, he was put in prison. Verse 4, handing him over to be guarded by four squads or four soldiers each. Herod intended to bring him to public trial after the Passover. So Peter was kept in prison, but the church was earnestly praying for him. Persecutions may come, opposition may come, but the church ought to pray. Hallelujah. There's even opposition for VBS. You know, yesterday we got a call and somebody tried to, threaten by saying, oh, you know, you're giving all of this for children, you know, all of this. But we as a church are praying together. Hallelujah. And the persecution or the opposition will not be able to stand. Amen. Hallelujah. God gave me the grace to speak to that man in the right way. God put words in my mouth and helped me to handle it. And God will handle him. Amen. Praise the Lord. When God starts handling things, it's become dangerous, you know, for people. And what happened? Verse 5. So Peter was kept in prison, but the church was earnestly praying to God for him. Church was praying. Hallelujah. What are we doing this morning, church? Are we praying? Are you praying? Hallelujah. Will you pray on second Saturdays? Amen. The number of yes is going down. Will you pray on fourth Fridays? It's only some ladies. Will you pray on fourth Fridays? No. Some people are not saying yes. But the church was earnestly praying. You know why we are not praying? Because we are not having persecution. Sometimes persecution makes the church to pray more. Yeah. That's true in history, church history. Because we are not facing persecution, some of us don't have the need to pray at all. Because we got our jobs, we got our studies, we got our jobs, we got our incomes, we got our own homes, we got cars, we got air conditioners, we got food, we got palamudir, we got more. We got everything. Right? We got malls. We got everything. And so there's no need to pray. But the church earnestly prayed to God for him. That night, before Herod was to bring him out to trial, verse 6, Peter was sleeping with two soldiers. You see, just now James, the brother of John, had been put to death. Peter is now seized, put in prison. Everybody knows that to please the Jews, they're doing this. And Herod has the power to. Now, this is not a democratic system where you go through the legal procedures and all of this. This is an autocratic system. The king decides, he can finish him off. Nobody needs to be asked. He can just kill him. That night, before Herod was to bring him to trial, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers bound with two chains. Sentries stood guard at the entrance. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared and a light shone in the cell. He struck Peter on the side, woke him up. Quick, get up, he said. And the chains fell off Peter's wrists. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Some of us are reading these kinds of portions of scripture and saying, Lord, we are so bound because of all these problems. You know what is the problem? Because the sister-in-law complained, you know, to the mother-in-law. These are the chains that are binding us. Lord, the enemy is resisting us. Like the soldiers who are, you know, persecuting. I am in a severe persecution because the sister-in-law said something very bad. This is the level at which we are at. Main huge persecution. The devil is persecuting me so much because somebody said something bad about me. But this persecution was about losing the life. Amen. Not about something, someone said something bad. Don't talk about all that as some kind of upathram. That's a very nice Tamil word that many Pentecostals love to use. Bhayangaramana upathram. What is upathram? Sister-in-law said something bad. If real persecution comes, upathram comes, we have to see how many are going to stand. We don't have this. So don't call your problems as some kind of big persecution. Don't compare it with these things in scripture. He is bound in chains. Tomorrow morning, he is going to be killed. When Herod brings him out, the next thing is going to be death. But here he is sleeping peacefully. Hallelujah. You see, that is strength. That is what is called spiritual strength. He was at peace. And the church was awake and praying. Hallelujah. We need a church that will stay awake and pray. Praise the Lord. Can we be the church that will stay awake and pray? Not after persecution comes, but even before that. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Then the angel said to him, put on your clothes and sandals. Verse 8, Peter did so. Wrap your cloak around you and follow me. The angel told him, Peter followed him out of the prison. And he had no idea what the angel was doing was really happening. He thought he was seeing a vision. They passed the first, second guards, came to the iron gate leading to the city. It opened for them by itself. Iron gates of cities opening by itself. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. God will do dramatic miracles. For what? Not that we will make it to America. Not that we will make more money. Dramatic miracles for the sake of the gospel. Brother, sister, we are not living here for ourselves. We are living here for God, for His kingdom, for His church, for the progression of the gospel. Hallelujah. Stop living for yourself. Stop praying for yourself alone. Don't be a selfish Christian. Pray for His kingdom. Be doing something for the expansion of His kingdom. Hallelujah. How long can we just be praying for ourselves and our own needs? And only telling sob stories about ourselves. It's time to get out of ourselves and look at the Word of God. It's all about living for Him, for His glory, preaching His kingdom, calling people to salvation. Getting people, snatching a dozen at least from the pits of hell. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen. Dramatic miracles to be done so that people will say Jesus is Lord. Hallelujah. Not just that we'll get more money. Not just that we'll become more famous. Not that we'll become better than others. What good, what profits a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? What profits a man if he gains everything for himself but does not gain anything for eternity? Amen. What good is it? If we have money and wealth and jobs and business and work and houses and vehicles and comforts and everything, but if we've not got anybody for His kingdom, when we go to heaven, are we going to go empty-handed? Why we need miracles? Why we need miracles? So that people will acknowledge and know Jesus is Lord. And the power of God will be revealed. You see what happened? They were shocked. In the morning, there was no small commotion. Verse 18. Among the soldiers as to what had happened to Peter. After Herod had a thorough search made for him and did not find him, he cross-examined the guards and ordered that they be executed. You know what happened? Then Herod went from Judea to Caesarea and stayed there a while. He had been quarreling with the people of Tyre and Sidon. They had now joined together, sought an audience with him. Having secured the support of blessed us, a trusted personal servant of the king. They asked for peace because they depended on the king's country for their food supply. Verse 21, on the appointed day, Herod, wearing his royal robe, sat on his throne, delivered a public address to the people. They shouted, "This is the voice of God, not of man." Immediately, because Herod did not give praise to God, an angel of the Lord struck him down. He was eaten by worms and died. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. If anybody does not give glory to God, if people look to anybody like God, this is what happens. You see, all this God did to show that He is God. Hallelujah. God is not here to just kill people. God doesn't take pleasure in killing people. But God does certain things in His wisdom to reveal Himself. To reveal Himself. Ananias and Sapphira fell dead at the feet of Peter because they didn't speak the truth and they lied to the Holy Spirit. They fell dead. And the fear about the apostles gripped the people. For God has to manifest Himself in dramatic ways. That's what we're going to pray for now. Can we pray for this? Hallelujah. That we will receive divine direction. That God will reveal Himself in dramatic ways. Not for our glory, not to meet our needs alone. Yes, God will meet our needs. Yes, God will give you good education. God will give you money. God will bless your work. God will bless your business. God will help you go abroad. God will open opportunities for you. God will do all of that. He knows what we need, the Bible says. We don't have to break our heads for that. But you start living for His kingdom, you start doing His work, God will open up everything for you. Hallelujah. You don't have to struggle with your life. But the point is, we got to understand the purpose of God and not be selfish. We need to ask God to do dramatic miracles like these. Dramatic things must happen where the city people will see and acknowledge there is God among the Christians. Hallelujah. They'll be shocked. They should be amazed. Dramatic miracles like that should happen. Hallelujah. Not that we'll become more famous. Not that we'll get a TV show and we'll sell more DVDs. That's what's happening. Are you getting what I'm saying? We will see dramatic miracles. God will do such things so that people will know that He is God. Can we just lift our hands and pray? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Everybody pray. Praise the Lord. If you understand what we're talking about, if you understand the Word of God, hallelujah. If you understand, if you acknowledge that my life is not about myself, if you say my life is not about my family, it's not about just who I want to be, it's not about what I want to get. It's all about Him. Hallelujah. It's all about Jesus. It's all about His church. It's all about His kingdom. It's all about, hallelujah, oh, seeing God manifested powerfully in the world today. God must be manifested powerfully. God's work must be manifested powerfully in the world today. Hallelujah. 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 Oh God, hallelujah. Like Peter came out of the prison, like the prison doors flung open automatically, like the angel brought him out, hallelujah, like Herod fell dead, hallelujah. Dramatic miracles will happen, oh God. Oh, people will be healed. Lame should rise up and walk. The lame people should rise up and walk. The disabled should rise up and walk. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Yes, Father. Oh, that God will be revealed, that cities will be shaken. Oh, there will be joy in the city. Hallelujah. When miracles happen, hallelujah. Acts 8:6 says, when the crowds heard Philip and saw the miraculous signs he did, they all paid close attention to what he said, which shrieks, evil spirits came out of many, and many paralytics, cripples were healed. So there was great joy in that city. Hallelujah. When will joy come to a city? When God moves, when the Spirit of God moves, when He moves through His church, when He moves through His people. Come on, lift your voices and pray. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Move in our midst, Lord. Through your power, through your mighty power. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, let not our lives be about ourselves. Let not our lives be self-centered, Lord. Let it not be about our needs, Lord. Let us not be praying for ourselves alone. Let us not be selfish Christians, Lord. Let us not be self-centered Christians asking for miracles for our lives alone. But let it be for your glory, for your kingdom to be established, for your church to be established. Oh, for your church was established in Samaria because of the miracles that happened, because of the evil spirits that left. Oh, because there was joy in that city and people came. Hallelujah. Sorcerers in Samaria, Lord, were out of business. Hallelujah. Were thrown out of business. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The man who claimed to have a divine power were thrown out of business, Lord. Hallelujah. Let every sorcerer, every evil magician in the city be thrown out of business in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. 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 Let them be, Lord, brought into the kingdom of God. Oh, let them be saved. Let them be set free. Oh, let them be baptized. Hallelujah. Oh, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Jesus, build your church, Lord. Hallelujah. You're the God of this city, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, you're the God of this nation, Lord. We declare it this morning. Hallelujah. As a church, we declare it. Come on, lift your voices and shout it out. Hallelujah. You are God over every one of our lives. You are God. You are God. And we declare it in the Spirit. In the Spirit. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. You're a God over our lives. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Oh, Jesus. We need you not just for money. We need you not just for our well-being. We need you not just for ourselves, not for our blessings alone. Help us not to be petty, Lord. Help us not to be petty Christians, oh Father. But Lord, help us to see the big picture. Open our eyes, Lord. Open our understanding, Lord. Enlarge our understanding, oh Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. To live for your kingdom, to live for your church. Lord, to build your church, to build your kingdom, Lord. Hallelujah. Yes, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise you, Jesus, God of the city. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Jesus. Oh, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Jesus, hallelujah, praise the Lord, Jesus, hallelujah. Thank you. has great things in store. God, what God wants us to do, we ought to do. Keep doing what you're doing. And do more. Hallelujah. Ask yourself the question, what can I do more to see God take this city? Hallelujah. Until every man, woman, and child acknowledge the name of Jesus. What can I do more to see every man, woman, and child acknowledge Jesus as Lord? We want to see every man, woman, and child come and worship God with us. Hallelujah. That was a vision that God gave to Apostle Paul in Acts chapter 18, and we close with that. In verse 9 and 10, after he was persecuted, he left the synagogue and went next door to the house of Titius Justus, a worshiper of God. Crispus, the synagogue ruler, and his entire household believed in the Lord. Many of the Corinthians who heard him believed and were baptized. Reading from Acts 18 verse 8. And verse 9. One night the Lord spoke to Paul in a vision. Do not be afraid. Keep on speaking. Do not be silent, for I am with you. And no one is going to attack and harm you. Because I have many people in this city. Because I have many people in this city. So Paul stayed for a year and a half teaching them the word of God. Hallelujah. There are many people in this city who do not yet know Jesus. There are many, many people in this city who live around us who do not know Jesus. There are many people. Last week, a very, very flourishing young IT professional, young boy, 26, 27 year old, in the prime of his life, going to launch himself into the next level, probably if he moves into a team leader level or something bigger than that, has great prospects for his future. Brilliant guy, exceptionally good, very, very well qualified, well educated engineer. Working at Infosys, earning over 60,000 rupees. Young boy, 60,000 rupees. You know what? God has been speaking to him. What are you doing? You're just earning money for yourself. What are you doing with this life? What are you doing for the people who are lost in the world? And God has been speaking to him for quite some time. He quit the job. He said, I'm going to serve God. I have one life. What's the point in just earning money? He quit the job. The next day after he quit the job, he sat down in his house with a friend and prayed for 3 hours, 10 o'clock to 1 o'clock. Prayed. 3 hours. Said, God, show me what I should do now. I quit the job. You called me to come serve you. What should I do now? He prayed. God led him to GH Hospital. He went to General Hospital, GH. You know, it's not a very pleasant place. Not a very clean place. He went there. He took a bunch of tracks. Took a friend along with him. Went and started praying there. And suddenly God showed him. There on the right side corridor, there will be a window there. And there will be a woman standing there and crying. And go talk to her. God showed that to him. And he sent this friend of his, go talk to her. And this guy went and saw. And there was a woman there. There was a window there. And standing there and crying. And that boy spoke to her and led her to Christ there. And he sat there and kept praying and talking to people and giving out tracts, telling people about Jesus, meeting people who came for emergency accident cases. A woman, a mother came there where a son was almost in dying stage in a meeting with an accident. He met the mother and the mother said, he met the mother, he gave the gospel and everything. And the mother said, if God gives life for my son, I'll give my son back to Jesus. She was not a Christian person. And he spent half a day at GH and at KMC, served the Lord, and came home. What a powerful thing. And his friend has been calling him from Maharashtra, somewhere in Maharashtra, and he's just willing to go. He's ready, saying, I'm willing to go. There are people who have never heard the gospel there. From the time of Christ, never heard the gospel there. So he's willing to go. Greater things are yet to come. We can clap hands. We can clap hands. But it comes with a price. I'm not calling us to leave our jobs. But how can we be so self-centered and money-focused and all about living up for our lives while we have a host of people around us who are perishing? How can we focus on ourselves alone? That's all that I'm challenging us for. There are great things that are yet to be done in this city. But it will be done only if you and I will work tirelessly. Amen. Hallelujah. If that 26-year-old young man, he doesn't care about how he's going to get married or who will give him a girl or how he's going to eat. How he's going to take care of his family. If we think of all of that, we can't serve the Lord. If all those people who serve God full-time think of that, you won't have anybody serving the Lord. Amen. How are we going to eat? How are we going to live? How are we going to marry? How are we going to pay our children's fees? It has to happen by faith. God is our provider. He will provide. Hallelujah. But you see the zeal. You see the heart of this young man who stepped out. He's from our own neighborhood. He's from our own neighborhood. Studied in SBOA school. Did engineering college here. Infosys. Local boy. Who can throw away his job. A very lucrative job. 60,000 rupees at this stage itself. It's not no small money. It's not 6,000 rupees. When things are small, it's easy to let go. When it's big, it's even more harder. Some people think, if God gives me more money, then I'll serve Him. The more it comes, the more difficult to let go. Hallelujah. Shall we make a commitment this morning that whatever it takes, I'm willing to serve God in whatever capacity, whatever grace God gives me, whatever area of gifting, calling, wherever God leads me, I'm willing. You just have to say, I'm ready, Lord. I'm willing. I'm not asking us to quit our jobs. But are we willing to live out of ourselves? Not living for our own selves, but to make a commitment to say, I'm not going to be silent anymore. I'm not going to be silent. I'm going to do something for the Lord. When I go to meet Jesus, I don't want to go empty-handed. Properties and money and wealth and riches and education, degrees will not accompany us. But what we do for Christ will last. Hallelujah. Keep doing your work. Keep doing your business. Keep studying. But beyond all of that, live for God. Live for God. There's only one life you can live. Live it for God. Hallelujah. Everything else will perish one day. We ourselves will leave this world one day. This is not our home. We're just passing through.
Things, Lord. Yes, Lord.